Nobody makes me bleed my own blood.
Hey guys, thank you for tuning in to another episode of InRange. We were recently at SHOT Show 2017, and Ian kind of grilled the Mossberg lady rep regarding their new Shockwave model. The Mossberg guys have done some interesting stuff in the past. You may remember their chainsaw shotgun, which maybe that would be, well, maybe you could use that for breaching or something, but I can't help but admit that it seems to just be kind of just coolness factor more than anything.
I'm sorry, you said coolness, but what I heard was stupid.
Okay.
Fair enough.
Maybe they're interchangeable. And so this year they've got the Shockwave. Now, Shockwave is another company that's been doing modifications to the Mossberg pistol grip pumps for a while.
Okay.
And now Mossberg's selling it as a product. And what they've done is they've taken a pistol grip pump, and instead of, they've reduced the barrel length, but extended the grip length so that it still meets the minimum legal requirements of being over 26 inches.
So there's a weird legal loophole here, and it really truly is a loophole, where what they're building is not a short-barreled shotgun, and it's not in any other weapon, because it starts out as just a receiver, and it never has a stock on it, which means it's not a shotgun. By legal definition, a shotgun, so we see here, we're
27 inches.
27 inches overall. Legally speaking, a shotgun is designed to fire from the shoulder, so it has a buttstock. If you never have this stock on, then this is a firearm that's not actually technically a shotgun. Now, because it's not a shotgun, it cannot be a short-barreled shotgun. The definition of short-barreled shotgun is predicated on it being a shotgun. And any other weapon is legally defined as being concealable, and ATF has specifically said that something over 26 inches long is legally, by definition, not concealable. So if the overall length is 26 or longer, it cannot be in any other weapon. As a result, what Mossberg is able to do, and we don't actually have one of the Shockwave guns here.
We'll talk about that more briefly.
We're not giving them money for it. But the idea is they can have a 26 and a half inch overall length, they can have a 14 inch barrel on the gun,
whoop,
and have a 26 and a half overall length.
You keep the overall length, but you reduce the barrel. Overall length, if you're holding it, it's the same length as this.
Exactly. That's an important thing that I want to make sure people understand right from the beginning. While we don't have a Shockwave, we have, I believe this is called the Persuader, which is exactly the same overall length. What the Shockwave does is it takes 4 inches off the barrel and puts them on the grip. It's got this bird's head grip that comes back. Honestly, it's like this without the stock on.
Essentially that. And so what that does, and I think there's probably truth to this, the recoil when you're shooting a pistol grip pump like this tends to go straight into the palm of your hand. It's a little rough.
Kind of sucks.
If you angle it like this, I would agree that the Shockwave design, or if you were gripping this as though they did not have a stock, is actually nicer to mitigate the recoil than this. Now, one other thing I want to add to that is the other reason that this is not a pistol is because it wasn't designed to be fired one-handed.
Right.
You could do this, we highly recommend against it, but it was designed to be fired two-handed, so therefore it's not a pistol, but it doesn't have a stock, so therefore it's not a short-barrel shotgun, leaving it in legal limbo.
It's just legally a quote-unquote firearm.
Now, this is where when you gave the lady a little bit of some ribbing, and I think that there was some to be deserved there because, and here's why.
I think I went light on them.
Okay, and the reason I feel that that's the case is that you kind of came at it as though this is worthless from a home defense perspective.
Weird, I kind of did.
And I don't think that that's true.
Okay.
I think this is possible and absolutely viable to be used in a home defense scenario or a combative scenario. I think you could push this into that role. Or with the Shockwave, maybe even a little better than this traditional pistol grip pump. However, when you look at the overall length of this, when they're making the argument that this is the perfect home defense weapon, that's when I have a problem with it.
Okay.
A shotgun is a fantastic home defense weapon. A shotgun with proper buckshot is the closest thing to a 100% one-shot stop on a meat target. Something not armored, not 100, nothing's 100, but it's the closest to putting a fight to an end with one round.
It's devastating.
Devastating, absolutely. So let me finish that thought. So where I was going with this is this. I see this as being very similar to a snub-nosed 357 J-frame.
Okay.
In that it's not worthless. It's an expert's gun. If you are really skilled with this and practice with this reliably, you could push this into a home defense scenario. However, you are actually stacking the odds against yourself than if you had a stock. And if you're not going to be out practicing constantly, you'd be better off with this because you're actually going to get the hits. Remember, a home defense scenario isn't always an individual intruder. In fact, frequently bad guys come in pairs or threes or fours. And we're going to test that today.
Yeah. So just to be clear, we have a difference of opinion here, but I'll agree, this isn't useless. You know, it does shoot. I just cannot think of any situation where I'd rather have that than this.
And that's the, we're similar on that one. Yeah. I would say that if you were choosing a shotgun for home defense, and your rationale for choosing it was not just to give the finger to the NFA. This is a finger to the NFA. If that's your gig, go for it. But if you're choosing it for actual practical defensive purposes, I do not see why, unless you have some extremely constrained storage requirement, why you would not just go with the stock and give yourself the benefit of the doubt of getting the hits when you need them.
I contend that over the course of this video, we will show that this not only makes hits just massively faster and more accurately than that, I'll contend that this is actually the more compact gun to actually use.
And we'll show that in a minute. So how we're going to do this is with the timer, because the timer does not lie. You can see this in a movie. You can see people shooting this stuff. You put it on the clock against targets at 7 yards.
Yep.
We're giving 7 yards for the replication of inside of a house. We've got 4 steel targets at 7 yards. And if we can get hits on that or not, with the timer, will tell us the truth.
Yep.
Is this viable? And if it is viable, is that better? So let's test that.
Let's do it.
All right, guys, this scenario is a single intruder into the house at 7 yards, 21 feet. Pistol grip, pump. What we're going to try and engage here is under the clock, one round on target.
Starting with the gun unloaded.
Starting with the gun unloaded, I have to pump it and bring it up and hit. I'm going to fire from the hip. We will try this later. I'm not a fan of that. We'll talk about that more later. From low ready.
Shooter ready. You missed.
I missed.
You're dead.
I am dead. Give it another try.
Okay.
Take two. I fired from the hip and missed, and I actually have done a lot of this kind of shooting at cowboy action. That was nothing more than the stress of a timer in the desert and a bathrobe. Let's try it again.
Ready. All right, good hit.
Time.
0.97.
0.97.
Ready.
Another good hit.
0.92. Ready.
I missed!
You're dead.
All right.
You missed in 1.24, by the way.
That's because it fouled up a little bit. All right. That is not a good result.
Aside, Carl is substantially more experienced with shotguns in general than I am. And my experience firing from the hip is minimal at best. So I'm going to have 3 goes at this, and we'll see how many hits I can make and in what time, and how much my hand hurts by the time we're done.
Stand by. Miss.
I missed. Yep.
Stand by. Miss.
Damn it.
Stand by.
Yeah.
Hit. 1.54.
Awesome.
Same test. Stocked. Exact same shotgun with a stock from the low ready.
0.89. 0.90. And you killed the target. 0.83.
So let's have a conclusion here real quick. So far, pistol grip pump. I fired 4 times at the target. It hit it successfully twice. The 2 times I hit it were 0.9 something. 2 other times I missed entirely and would have been killed. Gun with the stock, I shot 3 times, hit all 3 times, and we're under 0.9 with at least one of them.
My experience shooting stock shotguns is slightly greater than stockless shotguns, but still pretty scant.
Stand by. Hit. 0.96. Hit. 0.89.
Getting better.
Hit. 1.27.
Had a little bit of a fiddly with the thing there. So I made 3 hits for 3 shots, and every single one of them was faster than the 1 hit I managed to make with that pistol grip piece of junk. This is a great tool.
We got one more home defense shotgun, technically an Old West defense shotgun. It's a hammered coach gun. And I'm going to make the argument that while you only have 2 rounds for the average person with 2 intruders coming into their house, that's not well trained. The status of the triggers, telling them whether the gun is loaded or not, the ability to just merely close it when they need to shoot versus actually running a pump, means that they probably won't have malfunctions, which, by the way, I had 2 malfunctions with the pump guns with that ammo. Interesting to note. So we're going to start with the action open, hammers cocked, which is what we could use as an example of a safe gun in the house when trying to engage an intruder. On buzzer, I will close the action and engage the target.
.68.
.85. Both times faster. We'll do one more round to get three.
.79.
Huh. If you only need two rounds, this is the fastest home defense gun on the market.
Cocked.
Stand by. .78. Miss.
Oh, I missed.
Interesting.
A little too fast.
A little too fast. Load up one more. .84.
So I think one of the important things here to point out is that shotguns have to be aimed. And at close range, 7 yards here, the rule of thumb, and this is always something you want to confirm with your own ammo, but the rule of thumb is you get about 1 inch of spread on a shot pattern per yard of distance. So I am aiming a group about 7 inches wide at this distance. That means I can miss. Easy to miss with the pistol grip only. If you get too fast, especially if you shoot high, it's easy enough to miss with one of these as well. And I don't think there's any reason to put yourself at an automatic disadvantage to begin with by not having a stock.
So, at this point, we have now done one target engagement at 7 yards with three different shotguns.
Yep.
If you had to pick one shotgun to defend yourself with against one assailant in your house at this point, which one?
Pump with a stock.
I say this side by side.
Well, that's good, because it's yours.
Well, here's why I say that. Let me finish. You did miss once,
yeah,
but you had an immediate second shot.
It's true.
Now, if you get your ammo right, the pump gun should be fine. However, both of us foibled the pump a couple times.
That is true.
Unless you practice a lot with a pump action shotgun, it is actually possible, especially under stress, to short stroke the gun and induce a malfunction.
That is true.
You will not have that with this.
I'll still take the pump action with the stock.
We're going to differ on this. If I had to deal with one intruder in my house, I would take the side by side.
Well, okay, that's a little different.
Yeah.
If I know there's only one dude, then yeah, that changes things.
Let's move on to the statistical norm of two.
All right, so now we're going to go with two targets. We've got the Q target and the mini target, both at 7 yards and approximately 3 yards apart from each other. So, we'll get started.
No, pistol grip pump first.
Ugh. I really don't want to use that stupid thing. My hand hurts as it is. All right.
Shooter ready.
All right. Ready.
Stand by. Hit on both.
Yeah, got them both.
1.82. We'll pause for a moment to reset the dead target. The first hit was, you hit it, but it was not a great hit.
Okay.
1.81. I will say you're already getting better with that.
I am.
Yeah. Ready?
Got him. Time. 1.51.
1.51.
A mediocre hit on the second one, 1.48.
1.48. I got shrapnel.
Shrapnel?
Yeah, let me remind people at home, we are trained professionals.
In bathrobes.
Even at 7 yards, I mean, even a shotgun at 7 yards isn't the best idea. I mean, this is not a big deal. I got a little cut. Keep in mind that even I've shot at cowboy action matches where we shot really close.
Uh-huh.
This stuff happens. But we just want to remind people at home, don't replicate this. This is for science. And I'm willing to bleed a little bit, but don't do this at home.
If you want to replicate it, do it with paper. Then you'll actually see exactly where you're hitting.
Even better. We need steel for the reaction on camera. All right, now that I'm bleeding, I got my stock shotgun. We can do the same thing, two runs. Let's see what happens.
Ready. 1.50.
I think that was about the same time you had.
1.44.
I'll tell you what, the times might be similar. I feel way more confident with this. When I'm coming up on that target, I know I'm going to hit it. I'm not questioning if I hit it. And when I shoot the first target, it's obvious to me that I've neutralized it. I'm not like, there's no pause or hesitation there.
Are you ready?
Ready.
Stand by.
1.59, solid hits.
Huh, better hits, faster time.
All right. 1.59, exact same time. All right, hammered coach gun. Obviously, two assailants means we've got two rounds. Now, we don't know, maybe there's three, but in this instance, we've got two. Hammer's cocked, action open.
Ready? 1.18. Man, what? You killed it even with the rock.
1.18.
1.18, exactly the same. Are you ready?
Ready.
Stand by. 1.32. 1.22. Fastest
Fast.
Time.
You know what? When you're hunting big game in Africa, there's a reason that professional hunters tend to use double rifles. Because you have a second shot in case anything goes wrong with the first. Fractions of a second behind. No mechanical manipulation of the gun necessary. Switch to the second trigger, fire the second round.
The best times with the coach gun. Out of both the pump guns and this, just like Ian said in the last run, there's a reason double rifles are used against dangerous game. That second shot is immediate. There's no fumbling with the gun. You just pull the trigger again. Two guys down. I'm still on board with the coach gun.
All right, let's move on to three targets.
Three.
Hey, you don't get to start with that thing. If I have to start with the pistol grip, you do too. Yeah, that's right. Embrace the suck there.
All right. Now we've got three assailants. One of them's a little bit harder target. It's one of HMG's pistol targets. But you know when you hit it because it moves like a son of a bitch.
And if it doesn't move, you ain't hit it very well.
I didn't hit it. So I got three rounds, three bad guys.
Ready? 2.21.
That freaking sucks, by the way.
Yes, it does.
But I got him.
You did. Congratulations, you have proved that you can accomplish the goal with impediments.
I said that this was viable. Not good.
2.78 with a little bit of a hit.
I had a little foible there. That was me pumping the gun. That's what I was saying. Pump guns can be finicky. If you get the right ammo, it doesn't, but that's just an example. I did get all three hits.
Yep, 2.78. All right, back to this piece of junk.
Three intruders.
I shouldn't say that. This is a wonderfully made tool for hurting oneself.
Are you ready?
All right.
Stand by.
One good hit, one crap hit, one no hit.
Yeah, okay, we're not going to count it because you didn't get him. One more run.
No,
1.58 seconds to miss twice. That was a low hit. That third hit was not a hit.
Oh, yeah, I just plugged the base of that target.
2.63, and the third shot was a complete miss. All right, guys, now we got the gun that's actually viable. It's got a stock on it. It means you can actually aim and hit targets reliably. Without recoiling into the palm of your hand. Shockwave or not.
Shooter ready. Good hits. 1.87.
1.87. Same foible on this gun, which is fine. That means we're apples for apples. But even with the foible, it was still faster than the pistol grip only pump with the same foible.
20% faster. All right. Now I can finally get rid of that stupid one and use a proper shotgun here. Ready?
Stand by. 2.30, three hits.
And that's with a little bit of a wobble.
Yep. All right, now you get to move on to the coach gun.
All right,
now we got the coach gun. We're limited to two rounds. Now, if this was set up for a home defense scenario, you might have a shell carrier on the gun with extra rounds. We're just gonna have them in our hand like we grabbed them off the shelf. So obviously we're gonna have to reload. We know the times are gonna be slower, but how much slower are they?
Shooter ready? 10.22.
This is where the coach gun falls apart. But you might notice I missed but was able to take back the shot because I had a second round that was easy to come to.
6.55.
Not the end of the world, but I wouldn't want to be doing that in an actual fight in my house. So, viable, yes. Great option for three, no. I'm gonna kinda suck at reloading this thing, but we'll give it our best.
Ready?
Stand by.
Ah, come on.
$10.39.
Oh, I beat Carl's first run.
$8.37.
Not bad.
Not bad.
I think it is worth pointing out that this is a cowboy action shotgun. As such, it has extractors but not ejectors. If you were actually going to use a double for a home defense gun, I don't think there's any reason that you would deliberately do that. The no ejector thing is a specific rule of cowboy shooting. We are shooting Rio Royal low recoil buckshot. I bought a bunch of this for the Halloween shotgun match like a year ago, and I had trouble operating it in my martini style greener shotgun. Exactly. I found the cases seem to be slightly long, and they didn't want to eject, and they don't want to eject here, and they're giving us occasional malfunctions in the pump guns.
We're using it because we have it. We might as well shoot it. And I'll say that the occasional malfunctions in the pump gun and the fact that they don't just fall out of the coach gun are indicative of this is crap ammo.
Don't recommend the ammo, but yeah, we're not going to use this stuff in our own homes. We're not going to use it in matches, so we're going to shoot it up here for you guys.
I just wanted to make the point that the coach gun can be faster than that.
Yes, that's true.
With the right ammo.
Yep. All right, Kyle, I don't know why you're holding that. You clearly love this. You should have this.
Wow. Well, you know,
you're the one who says this is the best gun for everything.
No, that was Mossberg.
Oh.
And half the internet, right. Which is weird.
That's right.
So, I honestly, I don't know, maybe if, let's see how honest you are with yourself today. I think that we've proven the point this is viable and
yes.
Possible to be used. It is not worthless.
Okay, true.
You said worthless earlier today.
Worthless is a pretty low bar.
You said worthless earlier today.
Did I actually say
worthless? You said worthless.
If I said worthless, I was wrong and mistaken.
Okay, fair enough. That was the point we wanted to make.
Stupid and pointless.
Maybe, but not worthless. And if you practice the law, you could press this into service should you need to. The question I have is, why do you need this when you can use that? So, after testing this on the clock against 1, 2, and 3 assailants.
Yep.
Against 1 assailant and 2 assailants. The 1870s era coach gun with hammers wins.
Absolutely.
Devastatingly wins.
Yes.
Once you get to 3 assailants or have a miss, this falls out of the game. Now you've got the pump. That works.
Yep.
I don't believe we missed with that once.
Never.
The times were better with it reliably, even with foibles with the crap ammo.
Yep.
Good solid hits.
Yep.
And this was under nothing more than the stress of standing in the sun, dudes watching dudes, and a timer. If you're in your house, in an actual bathrobe, with someone kicking in your door, and you have that, you have this, do you truly trust your skills so much, and you practice so much with this, that you're a high master with a pistol grip pump, and you'd rather have this to defend your life and your family than that?
Now, you and I don't actually own these two shotguns.
No, we borrowed this from a well-known High Point collector.
Yes, a good friend of ours. Mm-hmm. And you know what, he pretty much, if there was such a thing, he would be a pistol grip only high master. He shoots them a lot. He really enjoys them.
He loves them.
And he's pretty darn good with them.
We have occasionally run two-gun action challenge match shotgun pistol matches.
Yep.
And he brings this out because he likes it. We actually have a category during a Halloween match called Action Hero.
Yep.
It's for the pistol grip pumps. Very few people do it. He does. And out of 50 shooters, he will place squarely in the middle. Mind you, he's a very good shooter.
In fact, when you grabbed these from him, you said, well, you know, you like that thing. Would you pick that as a home defense gun? And his answer was?
No, I would use the one with the stock.
Because no matter how much or how little skill you have, you'll be better with this than you will be with that. Now there are, I don't remember exactly, there may have been one or two strings where you, Carl, actually were faster with that than I was with this.
Yep.
But that's because you shoot a lot of shotgun. I shoot about as much shotgun as the average person who's buying a shotgun for home defense.
You know what? And I agree, I always go with the timer doesn't lie. And there were moments where this was slightly faster, perhaps, but let me say.
No, there were moments where you with that were faster than me with this.
Oh, okay.
And that's different than having equal
conditions.
Let me tell you, I am not, every time I fire this at the target, I am unsure if I'm getting the hit.
Mm-hmm.
When I fire that and pull the trigger, I know where my shot went, and I know that I slammed the target. When I shoot this and the target rings, I'm like, oh, I got it.
Oh,
move
good.
On. Whoa, you don't want,
surprise.
Oh, I got it. Move on. What you want to know is, I shot it, I hit it, I aimed at it, and when I pulled the trigger, my rounds went into it.
Right.
With this,
that's
you have that. With this, it's, wow, I did it. Gee whiz.
There are people who are going to say, well, obviously it was slower, and you're missing because you're shooting from down here.
Mm-hmm.
You should shoot it using the sights.
Oh, you mean like this?
Yes.
Well, two things on that come to mind. One, and we could test that in a moment, I don't like the idea of this because under stress, you might get it too close and punch yourself in the face. The last thing you want in a high stress scenario when you're fighting two assailants is to punch yourself in the face with your own gun. Now, maybe you practice enough that that never happens, but what you've done to prevent that is either A, you've deprecated the power of the ammo to the point there's no recoil, which means you reduce power.
Which is exactly what Mossberg was talking about because they had these things loaded up with Aguila mini shells.
Right. Or you're pushing out far enough that you know in your mind you're not going to eat it. And if you push it out far enough to know you're not going to eat it, you're actually extending the length of the gun longer than when you're using a stock.
When actually used in a way that you can aim, this is going to be longer. So, I need to push it out. Right about there. Muzzle is in contact with the target. Leaving my feet planted, same stance, stocked gun, couple inches shorter. It's not just about the physical length of the gun, it's about how you're going to actually hold it. And, of course, if you need to be a lot shorter, there's no reason you can't put that stock under your arm, and not only does that shorten the gun up, it also gives you a better point of index for the gun. In every way, this is better than a pistol grip only gun.
And I also want to point out, our friend, who shoots a lot with these things, he had an incident where he ate the gun once, didn't he?
He did, although that was an accident.
Well, you know what? It's always an accident. You never do it on purpose. What happens is you're out shooting, and you're like, birdshot, birdshot, birdshot. Oh, somehow a 3-inch slug got into my ammo.
Now, to be fair, he was shooting one of those little tiny, like, crazy...
Super shorties.
And he was... loading it and didn't realize he got a 3-inch magnum round in the chamber into the magazine, ran it, and when he fired it, it went up and actually did this. And it hit him here and it knocked his teeth in. And he had to hike back to society because he was out in the forest to get his teeth straightened out. Now, mind you, if there's no 3-inch magnum shells around to accidentally get into your gun, but if that were to happen and you're doing this and you're expecting and you actually get blam, that's also a problem. Yeah.
Doesn't have to be a 3-inch magnum. It can be a regular slug when you've been shooting birdshot.
And I question why you'd want to download your ammunition power only to get recoil mitigated when you could just use a stock.
And it's actually shorter.
You know, there's one other thing that comes to mind real quick.
Yeah.
You know, I know it sounds like we're wrapping up, but...
No, there's more. There's more.
There's more to this, right? So we fired buckshot all day today because that's your realistic home defense load. In fact, we use low recoil buck. Right?
Because it's what we had.
Now, let's go a little bit into the tactical Ted scenario.
Okay.
But a real one. What about a hostage target?
Bad guy breaks into the house, grabs your kid, grabs your spouse, whatever.
And he's doing this, and you've got a head right behind your spouse. Would you aim this? Yeah. Would you want to aim this to neutralize that head behind your loved one?
You like that thing so much, I think you should have to try it.
Let's try it. We have a hostage target out here today. Let's find out what happens.
Whatever. There are two hits right here from a previous test. One there, one there. If there's more than two after this, that means I hit my spouse when trying to engage the hostage taker.
And this is, again, 7 yards.
And I'm going to shoot it that way.
Ready? Complete miss. Your spouse has been shot in the head.
Well, no, I didn't hit my spouse, but I intentionally was careful and as a result missed entirely.
Yeah, the bad guy killed your spouse.
Let's try it with the stock.
You want to try it one more time?
Sure.
Because it's so much fun?
I don't like it. Oh!
You skimmed him.
I did not hit my spouse, but I barely nicked the hostage target. Didn't neutralize it.
All right, let's see if you can do better with a stocked gun.
Let's do the stock gun. That's still a nerve-wracking thing with a shotgun no matter what.
Oh, extremely.
Yeah.
But if you know your pattern, and you know how to aim the thing, it can be done. Ready?
Yep.
All right, let's see if you got her too.
Nope, it's clean.
Your time, by the way, was 1.59.
1.59.
You got the shot off faster, substantially faster, than with the PGO, and you actually hit.
Yep. Do we do it twice, or you want to go now?
Yeah, you want to do it again?
See if I can do it twice.
That's a fun shot to make. Ready?
Yep. Not that time.
Not quite so good.
I did not hit the spouse, but I did neutralize the hostage target. Or the hostage taker.
All right, now it's my turn.
Your turn. Are you ready?
Ready.
Stand by. You did it.
Did get him.
2.09. Did you hit the hostage?
Let's go take a look. Do not appear to have hit the hostage.
All right, so you succeeded in doing this with the pistol grip pump. Are you ready?
Ready.
Stand by. 1.21.
What? I don't think so.
Nope.
I don't see anything new. So there you go, guys. It can actually be done, but why would you deliberately slow yourself down by not having the stock?
All right, so we tested really a couple different scenarios on the clock. If you're not testing on the clock, you're not testing. At least that's my opinion, and that's what the InRange approach is to these topics.
Yes.
The timer brings a mental stress to it that isn't there otherwise, as well as things happen on the clock that inexplicably don't happen off the clock.
This is true. Yeah. And the clock takes all opinion out of it. It's fact. Time is time. The timer doesn't lie.
Like, for example, you did neutralize the hostage taker with this when you did not expect to in a reasonable amount of 2 seconds.
That's true.
When we didn't expect you to do that, but the clock showed that you did it faster.
Oh, twice as fast. More than
twice
as fast.
Well, not twice. It was 2 versus 1.2.
It was 2.5.
No, that was 2.09. Doesn't matter.
At any rate.
Faster with the stock.
Substantially faster.
So we did single, double, and 3 assailants in your house at 7 yards, and we did a precision shot. We also demonstrated that this, when you're using it like this, is actually longer than the stock gun, and the stock gun can be shorter if you need it to be while moving around a structure.
Yep.
So with that posed, I think the conclusions are still, for me, exactly what I thought they were when we started, to be honest, is, and that's just because of experience, guys. I've shot a lot of this stuff. That's why I come to these conclusions before we start the video. This is an expert's gun. It can be used. It is no different than a 357 J-frame. Should you depend on your life as your primary gun to be a 357 J-frame or this? No. If this is all you got, you got it. If you were breaching with something and this is what you land up having, you've got it. But why would you use this when you could have this?
This does everything better.
It does everything better. The only reason to buy this is if you're breaching doors.
Nobody actually breaches doors who's not in the Army.
Or military or combat zone, right?
Or a cop. But if you're a cop. If you're a cop breaching doors, you're not going to buy that anyway. They're going to provide it to you, and you're not going to have a choice in what you're using.
And by the
anyway.
Way, you can still breach with this, too.
Uh-huh.
The only reason you breach with this is because it's easier to carry around. But you can still breach with a stock shotgun and have it useful for combat purposes,
mm-hmm.
should you need it. Or if you have some weird storage requirement where you can't fit that anywhere else. Like, for example, you live in one of those little Japanese, like, box apartments or something.
But you know what? Even in that situation, you can get folding stocks for guns like this.
And then that would be just as short as this, but you could extend the stock and then have a stock.
Yeah.
So, unless your entire purpose is to look like you're in the movies, or give the finger to the NFA, which might be your reason, then you could pick one of these.
That's fine.
If your goal
is... I've got no problem with people giving the finger to the NFA.
No, or if you want to be cool and you want to have fun at the range and try not to punch yourself in the face, you know what? Have at it. I'm not saying it isn't fun.
Well, it isn't fun.
Actually, I don't like it. But but if you think it's fun, cool, man. If you like movies that have this in it, better. If you want to give the finger to the NFA, buy one. If you're buying it for home defense, don't buy this. You're better off with a coach gun with the likelihood of having 2 assailants versus 3 in your house than you are this, unless you practice constantly. And if you practice constantly, you'll be better with that than you were with this.
And you know what? I know we're going to get a lot of comments from people who say, well, yeah, but I'm different because I practice a lot. And what you just said is valid, but also, I think most people don't practice all that much. Not as much as you may think you do. I mean, the people who are experts with these guns are shooting them a lot more than would be considered rational or normal by most people. You know?
That's a very fair argument.
I think there's a difference in expectation of what is a lot of practice.
Our well-known high point collector probably would agree he's not rational or normal in his approach to the pistol grip pump.
But you know what? He also considers it a fun toy.
Yeah.
And when it comes to home defense, you won't find him using that thing. You'll find him using this.
So I know it sounds like we came into this with a bias because we did come into it with a bias. That said, I feel like Ian was a little too harsh on the Mossberg people. And I think that we wanted to prove today that this was viable. And it is. Is your mind changed? Is this viable? Could you use this if you had to?
Well, Yeah. This is not only... You know what I haven't even mentioned? This is cheaper. I can go buy one of these at a pawn shop for like half the price of that thing. I cannot come up with any scenario in which that's my only actual choice.
Okay. Is it worthless?
Yes.
I can't convince you.
No.
I do not agree that it's worthless. If you came to a table, there was two guns in the house, and you had to fight two assailants, there is a 9mm pistol and this. Which do you pick?
Pistol.
Yeah, I probably would too, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Now, I've got the one. If you knew you were having a home invasion and you had to pick one of two guns, and one was this, and one was a Nagant revolver.
Oh, I would take this.
Okay.
Yeah. So there are instances...
In that case, but that's about it.
There are instances. So you will concede it's better than a Nagant revolver.
I'll say that point's up for argument. That's a debatable one.
Fair enough.
I'd take a Type 94 Nambu over this.
Yeah, I could see that. All right, we're not going to convince him. However, I still think it's viable, but it's not the best choice, nor should it be advertised as the best choice. So with that said, you can look at the data for yourself. It's in this video. Make your own conclusions. We're not here to convince you otherwise. We're just showing the data as we see it. So thank you for tuning in to another episode of InRange. If you like this kind of depth, you know, fact-finding kind of stuff, please consider supporting us on Patreon. It paid for all of this shot that we fired today.
It's going to pay for my orthopedic work on my thumb here.
If you can't support us on Patreon, the next best thing you can do is subscribe to the channel and share this video with your friends. And we thank you for watching.
This. Sorry. Damn it. He's better with a shotgun than a tape measure.
Clearly I'm not a Mexican laborer. Alright, good enough.
Yeah, go for it.
Hey guys, thank you for tuning in to another episode of InRange. We recently were at SHOT Show 2017 and Ian's thing just went bing.
How is it Carl is texting me even while he's standing here?